Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. I'm so glad that you've joined us today. My name is Ramirez Moody, and I serve as the associate pastor of our young adult and compassion ministries at our Rolling Meadows campus. And this is my wife, Kathleen.
Welcome. We would love to know where you are watching from today. Let us know down below in the chat or in the comments. Guess what today is?
What?
Dr. V. Dr. Vanlaningham is bringing us God's word today from Romans 8 as we continue in our series, The Road to Reality. Dr. V serves on staff as a pastor of biblical research. Before coming to Harvest, he taught at Moody Bible Institute. What a blessing he is to us. We look forward to what God will teach us through his word today by his spirit.
Yeah, I'm so looking forward to that. And we thank God for the good work that he's doing in and through our church. And we know that God is at work in and through you as well. So what's on your heart today? What are you praying about? We would love to know what that is and join you in that prayer. So tell us here in the chat. Harvest, right now, we get to worship. So let's worship the Lord together in spirit and in truth, no matter where you're watching from today. Let's worship the Lord together.
Well, hey, church, we just want to invite you to worship with us. Wherever you are, where two or more are gathered, he is there. Jesus, the Spirit of God, is there and is present. So why don't you lean in with us and sing this with us.
I'm standing on the edge of everything I know. Comfort is behind me. I've got to let that go. Freedom in the free fall. When I'm falling into you, God knows where I'm going. Yes, he does. Maybe I don't have to. Come on, we sing.
You are in control. I find my life when I give it up. So I give it up. I can trust your love.
Welcome you to our online service. My name is Kathleen Moody, and this is my husband Ramirez, who serves as one of the pastors at Harvest. We are so glad you're here with us today. And if this is your first time joining us online, a very special welcome from us to you. Thank you for joining us.
Yeah, it's going to be a great time. And whether you're new or you come every week, we want to invite you to check in. You can do that on this page through a link in the comments or on the Harvest app. We'd love to know that you're here today. And more importantly, we'd like to know how we could be praying for you this week.
God has been so good to us. We thank the Lord for his faithfulness to us as a church through our faithful giving. It's a show of obedience. Yeah. So we want to encourage you to continue to give to the work that God is doing in and through our church. You can give online, on the Harvest app, through a text, or by mailing your gifts to the Rolling Meadows campus. I invite you to do that now or anytime this week.
Yeah, you know, we're always in need of each other. And that's never been more true than in 2020, right? If you're not in a small group, we want to help you get connected. This is where mutual ministry, care, practical applications of God's word, and community take place. We offer groups throughout the week, both in person and online, whatever you prefer. We want to help you grow in your walk with Christ. So to find out more details about joining a small group, go to harvestnow.info.
Another pillar of our church is working for the Lord, and we want to give you a place to serve and work for the Lord. Yeah. God has entrusted each one of us with gifts, abilities, and passions. Let us come alongside you and find a place for you to work for Christ here at Harvest. For me, for example, I serve on the medical response team, and I help out in Harvest Kids with my daughter, and I also help you in the compassion ministry with the food drives we have for the holidays and for our homeless ministries. We offer ways for each and every one of us to serve here from home or in person, during the week or on the weekend. Take this step to work for Christ at Harvest. Yeah. Get more details at harvestnow.info.
Yeah. Will you join me as we pray for our service today? Lord, we thank you for an opportunity to come together and worship your Son. We're so thankful that we have this medium, that even though we're in separate places, we can come together in this one place. And we're grateful and thankful for that. So God, we just ask that you'll have your way in the service today and let our praise be acceptable to you. And we ask these things in Jesus' name, amen. As we continue to worship, let's lift our voices to the Lord together now.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain moved. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight on my knees, with my head lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, and I'll sing through.
There's nothing impossible for you.
Stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows.
Yeah. you've done before in greater measure. You will do again.
Let's sing that again.
We've seen what you can do, oh God of wonders. Your power has no end. Thank you, the things you've done before in greater measure, you will do again. Cause there's no prison wall you can't break through, no mountain you can move. All things are possible, and there's no broken body you can't raise, no soul you can't save. Possible,
I believe it.
The darkest night, you can light it up. Yes, you can light it up. God of revival, let hope arise. Cause death is overcome, and you've already won. And now you're seated forever on the throne. For why should my heart fear what you've defeated? I will trust in you alone. Cause there's no prison wall you can't break through. Talking.
revive. Pour yourself out. Pour yourself out. To sing over this month, to sing over this week. Pour yourself out, Lord, into our homes, into our cities, into our workplaces. Pour yourself out. Pour your light out in dark places. Pour your healing out in broken places. Pour your truth out, God. In places where there are lies, pour out yourself, Lord. You're the only answer. There's no other answer but you. There's no other king in a kingdom but you. There's no other authority that we can trust and stand beside but you. And there's no one who can revive the soul but you. Pour yourself out, God. One more time. Come awaken. Come awaken your peace. Come awaken this city, please. Oh God of revival, pour it out. Pour it out. Where every stronghold will crumble, and we'll hear the chains hit the ground. When God of revival, you pour yourself out, pour yourself out, because you're great. You're great. Great are you, Lord.
God, because of your greatness, that we can trust you. It's because of your goodness, God, that it makes our burden light. So God, we thank you for who you are. And as we bring ourselves, God, I love that we just sing, Jesus, we love you. And Lord, would that be what we carry with us each and every day, God? That you get our love and our devotion. Lord, would that be the posture of our lives, God? So God, I pray, Father, that this time that we gathered all across, Lord, that, Lord, your name was glorified. Because, God, you're so worthy of our praise. You're worthy of our admiration. And would it then in return, God, turn our hearts with gratitude, Lord, to who you are and what you do. Thank you, Lord. Thank you that we get to gather and we sing your name. We love you. You're so good. In your name we pray. Amen.
How are we doing, guys? How's everything going? You all right? Staying at home? Watching church? Hope so. We're here to serve you and hopefully for the Lord to use us to be a blessing to you. And so we're thrilled that you've decided to join us. So I would invite you to take your Bibles. We're going to go to Romans chapter 8, and we will be looking at verses 26 through 30 today. We're going to be spending most of our time in verse 28. Now, I want to tell you, Romans 8, 28 is my life verse. And here's how it became that. I mentioned several weeks ago, when I was preaching on Romans 1, that there was a girl named Diane who was instrumental in me coming to know Christ. Well, just about 3 or 4 weeks after I trusted Christ, Diane had everybody in our Bible study over to her house, and she and another friend had fixed a meal for us, and we were just going to get together and hang out and have a time of fellowship. When we all got there, she handed to each one of us a little recipe card with a Bible verse specifically for us, for that person. She handed me this pale blue recipe card, blank on one side, lines on the other, and on the side with the lines, she had written out Romans 8, 28. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. And I'll never forget reading that a time or two, and then looking at Diane and saying, does this verse really mean what it seems to say? And she said, yes, Mike, you can take it to the bank. Those were her words. Romans 8:28 became my life verse on the spot, right at that moment. And I can't tell you how many times it has steadied me and my wife and my kids through various challenges that we have faced in our life in the past. So it'll be a pleasure for me to be able to walk us through Romans 8, verses 26 through 30 to set the context for Romans chapter 8. Now, in Romans chapter 8, the Apostle Paul is continuing, and then at the end of the chapter, he'll conclude his discussion of the results of being right with God. We would see in the book of Romans, chapters 1, 2, and 3, everybody's a sinner. Everybody is under the wrath of God. But God himself provides a solution to that problem. And that's the end of chapter 3 and chapter 4. And that is that God counts righteous those who place their faith in his Son, Jesus, who died on the cross as an atoning sacrifice for sins and rose from the dead to indicate that his death was sufficient for that. Then in chapters 5, 6, 7, and 8, the Apostle Paul explores kind of the so what of all of the wonderful truths of the gospel. The so what are the privileges that we enjoy. We get to enjoy life even in the midst of hardship. We can have rejoicing. In Romans chapter 6 and 7, we are free from the total and absolute domination of sin. And that brings us to chapter 8, where Paul says, we have life in the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit dwells within us. And that's an enormous privilege. He ministers to us. He blesses us. He does so much on our behalf to the glory of God. And that's what brings us up then to Romans chapter 8. And looking at verse 26. Now, what the Apostle Paul is going to do is he's going to present in verse 26 through 30 three more blessings that come to us because of the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And so those three blessings are the fact that the Spirit himself prays for us, verse 26, 27, that the Father cares for us in hard times, that's Romans 8, 28, and third, that the Father accomplishes his eternal purposes for us, verse 29 to 30. These are things that the Spirit plays a role in. All right, so here's the first blessing that we have, and that is that the Spirit himself prays for us. Look at verse 26. Paul writes, likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. Now, he starts out by saying, likewise, we find that in verse 24 and 25, hope sustains us. The hope of an eternity with God sustains us even when we suffer. And not only does hope sustain us, but the Spirit also, in his prayer on our behalf, he sustains us as well. So Paul says the Spirit helps us in our weakness, specifically the weakness when we pray. Now, there's all kinds of controversy here in verse 26 right out of the gate. In verse 26, it says the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. Now, our charismatic friends, and they are our friends, will look at this and almost universally say that this refers to speaking in tongues. It could be that. I used to think that myself, but I don't think that's actually the best understanding. Here's why. Notice that it says in verse 26 that the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. When a person speaks in tongues, they're participating in that activity themselves. But here, Paul makes it emphatic that the Spirit is doing this. Also, he is interceding with groanings too deep for words. That phrase, too deep for words, is one word in the original language, and it refers to that which is either unspoken or unspeakable, that which remains unuttered or which cannot be uttered. But if it is unspoken, and if it cannot be spoken, then there's nothing that's audible. We will not hear anything. But when a person speaks in tongues, you hear what's going on. Okay, so notice the Spirit does this. He does it with unuttered groanings. And also, we know that in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 30, and let me read that, 1 Corinthians 12, 30, not all believers speak in tongues, but apparently all believers enjoy this ministry of the Spirit. In 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 30, Paul writes, all do not have gifts of healings, do they? All do not speak with tongues, do they? And the grammar there expects the answer, no, they don't all speak in tongues. And yet, while not all Christians speak in tongues, all Christians are promised this amazing prayer ministry of the Spirit. Now, the Spirit, Paul goes on in verse 27, and he says, and he who searches hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. Now, we tend to look at this and think to ourselves that what Paul is doing is talking about how the Spirit comes along, sees what we're praying in our hearts, And that he sort of, you know, makes that go up to God or something like that, but that's not really the point at all. The idea is that if God, who knows what's going on way deep inside the human heart, since God has that capacity because of his omniscience, then it's a piece of cake for him to understand what the Spirit is praying on our behalf. That is, there's no indication here that what we're talking about is prayer in our own heart. This is rather something that is taking place strictly between the Holy Spirit and God the Father. And it's easy. If God understands everything, then he gets what the Spirit is praying for on our behalf. Or to put it differently, God never misses the text messages that the Spirit sends to him. He always gets it. He always looks at it, and he knows what's going on. And so the Spirit is there praying for us. God knows what the Spirit is saying. There's this amazing sort of, and I don't know what other word to use, kind of a telepathic thing going on between God the Holy Spirit and God the Father on our behalf. Now, a couple other things I want you to notice here. So the Spirit intercedes for us. But look at chapter 8 and verse 34 as well. Paul writes, "Who is the one who condemns? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us." All right, so listen to this. The Spirit, the third member of the Godhead, prays for us. He intercedes for us. But so does the second member of the Godhead, Jesus, the Son. He's praying for us as well. Oh my goodness, guys. No wonder all things are going to work out for good for us. Romans chapter 8 and verse 28. And so I have to say, in all honesty, I don't really understand very much about this prayer ministry of the Spirit. It's not found anywhere else in Scripture. But I'm going to propose to you that it sounds kind of cool that the Spirit does this for us. Tom Schreiner, in his great commentary on Romans, talks about the connection of this ministry of the Spirit to what comes in verse 28 and afterwards. He writes, "We can see how nicely this fits with the next verses, where Paul teaches that all things work together for good, and that God has designed all things so that we are conformed to the image of his Son. No wonder all things are working out for our good. The Spirit is effectively praying for us so that the will of God will be accomplished in our lives." Praise the Lord. What an astonishing privilege for us to know that the Spirit prays for us. Here's the second blessing, where we're going to spend most of our time, Romans 8, 28. And that is, not only does the Spirit pray for us, but the Father cares for us in hard times as well. And I want to suggest that he does it in answer to the Spirit praying for us on our behalf. In verse 28, "And we know that for those who love God," more on that phrase in a little bit, "that for those who love God, all things work together for good to those who are called according to his purpose." Now, Tim Keller has a great paraphrase of Romans 8, 28 that I want to read very briefly before we go on. He writes, "If we follow Christ, our bad things turn out for good. Our good things cannot be lost, and all our best things are yet to come." His paraphrase of Romans 8, 28. It's pretty good. Notice what happens here. The Father works everything together for good. The word together here, or to work together, is a very interesting Greek word. It's the word, and I'm going to tell you what it is, synergy. Synergy. We get the English word synergy from this word. And the idea of this synergy is that God takes everything that's happening in the world and he has it all work in a coordinated way so that good ultimately comes our way. Now, there's a question here. How should this be translated? The ESV says all things work together for good. The HCSB, the King James, several other versions of the Bible say that as well. But other versions, like the NASB or the NIV, say something like, "He works together all things for good." or he makes all things work together for good. So which is it? Do all things work together for good, or does God make all things work together for good? I think it's the second one. I think this is what God does. He is sovereign over these things, and he makes them work together for good. Now, I just want to suggest that not everything that happens to us in our life is good. We're going to see that in a second. But that's not the nature of this promise. He is not saying here that God makes everything happen to us all the time and it's always and only good. Rather, he promises to bring good out of even the hard things that we go through. We have a tendency to think that when we encounter difficulties, God turns his face from us. I'm here to tell you, the actual perspective biblically is not that he turns his face from us. Rather, when hardships come, that's him turning his grace toward us. We tend to think that when we go through hardships, that those things are making our lives sick, that that's the disease that clings to our soul or something, is the hardship we go through. But I'm here to tell you, the hardships that we go through have been sovereignly planned out by God to be a blessing to us, even the worst things, and that he uses these things for our good, for our advantage. Our hardships are God's hospital to make our souls whole. And we're thinking, no, that's not how it goes. When we go through hardship, it's hard. Yes, it is. But we have to remember where God is in the midst of all of this. We're going to continue. So God works together all things. Okay? Now, here, we're going to get into some challenging stuff. But before we go on, right where you're sitting, I want you to repeat the phrase, all things, 3 times. Ready? All things, all things, all things. God works together all things for good. This is comprehensive. And the all things here, the all really means all. So let me just suggest that this would include even when your spouse was unfaithful to you, when your business partner stole all of your assets, when your roommate stabbed you in the back to your friends, when your 3-year-old died of leukemia, when as a young black man you get stopped for the 17th time in 3 years because of racial profiling when you're driving through a white suburban neighborhood, or if you're the police officer who has to stop somebody and do racial profiling, even though you know it's wrong and you can't stand to do it, but it's required of you. All things. All things. Even the crazy stuff that's happened here at Harvest Bible Chapel is not outside of God's loving and sovereign will. And here's the thing that we have to keep in mind. God's sovereign will is also laced with his love. He is at the same time a sovereign God, which means he superintends everything that happens in the universe, even, as hard as it is to comprehend, even sin, evil, and suffering. He superintends that for his glory and our good. Because he is sovereign then, and because he is loving, the things that he has determined would come into our life are part of his loving and sovereign plan for us to bring about some good. Now, we evangelicals, and that's us, right? That's us. We evangelicals have a tendency to think that's not what God does. So I want you to look at my podium, the edge of my podium right here. And I just want you to imagine that this podium represents a hardship that a believer is going through. Now, we believe that God is sovereign because he says at the end of our hardship over here that we're going to be seeing good that will come about. It requires a sovereign God who can do that, bring good out of even really hard things. But we have a tendency to deny him his sovereignty here at the start of our hardship. I've heard way too many folks say, well, what's going on here? That's not part of God's will for your life. And I would simply say, well, then, is God shocked by this? Is he surprised by what's happening here? Or in some way, has he predetermined this for your ultimate blessing? Now, that's really hard to have. It's hard to see it that way. But if we're going to have God's sovereignty here, when he brings good out of our hardship, we have to believe that he is sovereign here at the start of it. You cannot have it one way or the other, sovereign here but not here. If he's sovereign here when hardship starts, then he's got to be sovereign here to bring it about. And if he's not sovereign about how things come into our lives, then there's no guarantee that he's going to be sovereign enough to bring good out of it. So we can't have it both ways. But I'm here to tell you that God is sovereign both at the front end of the hardship that comes into our life and when he brings good out of it. The problem is, in all of this, it is so hard, if not impossible, to predict what he's going to do. And that brings us to our third point here in Romans 8:28. The Father works together all things for good. The word good here refers to that which is morally, spiritually, and tangibly beneficial for us. Please note that God works all things together for our good, not for our ease, not for our convenience, not for our comfort, not for our financial prosperity, for that which is morally and tangibly and spiritually beneficial for us. That's what he does. I take it that when we go through hardship, some of the good that God might develop in us is that when we go through difficulty, we have a tendency more frequently to lean into God. We might also lean more into his word. All of those are good. We might lean more into our Christian friends and into the body of Christ. Those are good things that we should be doing. But all of this is incredibly unpredictable. We don't know, obviously, when the hardships are going to come, and we cannot say in advance what the good is that God's going to bring out of it. But I think it's something that we're going to experience in this life. God works all things together for good. That includes both things now and in eternity. I don't think that we were only looking at eternity. Paul Tripp, in his book entitled Dangerous Calling, talks about how God's work here is mysterious. He writes, the fact of the matter is that we will never figure God out. He will never do all the things that we were expecting. He will never stay on our agenda page. He will never be comfortably predictable. If we rest in God's care only when we understand just what he's doing, there will be many times and places where we won't rest in his care. The danger in all of this is this. We simply do not run for help to someone whom we have come to distrust. It is in the moments of hardship when what God is doing doesn't make any sense that it is all the more important to preach to ourselves the gospel of his unshakable, unrelenting, ever-present care. He is actively caring for you and me. Even in those moments when we don't understand his care and can't figure out what he is doing. How many of us have never been in a situation and we've wanted to go, God, I don't get it. Why? What is going on? Well, at those moments we need to preach to ourselves, Romans 8:28, that he's sovereign even here and loving. And he will bring about good. I don't know how many years ago it was, but I was driving into Moody Bible Institute one morning very early, and I happened to be listening to Moody Radio that morning, And there was a song that came on that I had never heard before. And it was really early, and it was really dark, and I was all alone. And I can't remember what was going on in my life, but when I heard the song, it just made me sob. And the song is by Laura Story, and it's entitled Blessings. And I just want to read the chorus to you of this song. She says, because what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if 1,000 sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if my greatest disappointments or the aching of this life is a revealing of a greater thirst this world can't satisfy? And what if the trials of this life, the rain, the storms, the hardest nights, are your mercies in disguise? And I'm here to tell you that they are. Once upon a time, I was on staff at a big church in Southern California, a church you've never heard of, so don't even think about trying to figure out what it is. It was a long time ago. My first ministry experience, and it didn't go so great. It seemed like no matter what I did, I was messing up, and I was ticking people off, my superiors. I was making them mad because I just couldn't do a very good job whatsoever. I was 25 years old at the time. And I got really depressed. And then I got suicidally depressed. And one afternoon, I decided just to go home early from work, and I knew my wife would not be there. And I had determined that I was going to take my life. And I was going to use immediate and lethal means to do it. But as I was preparing to take my life, God brought to mind Romans 8:28. And I knew that if I had taken my life, I would have missed out on the good things that God had in store for me still. Those struggles, among other things, are what made me a good prophet, Moody Bible Institute. When I talked about pastoral hardship, I had immediate credibility with the students because they knew about my background. And they would listen to what I'd have to say. I just think of everything I would have missed out on. I would have missed out on my kids. Neither of them were born at that time. 40 years more with my wife. And so I'm so glad that I didn't take my life. God brought good out of those things even then. I think, for example, in the Old Testament, I think of Joseph. How it was that he was beat up by his brothers, thrown into a pit, then hauled out of the pit, sold to a caravan, sold into slavery, taken down to Egypt, and he endured such horrendous things there. And what does he say at the end of his life when his brothers come back and he interacts with them and he forgives them? He says, as for you, to his brothers, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good to bring about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. God meant it for good. It's the same word that we have in Romans 8:28. God works all things together for good. And so we see the principle played out, lived out in Joseph's life. Now, this is for those who love God. And we might think, well, this is only for super Christians, for Christians who really, really, really love God. No, but then look at the next phrase, because he develops that idea of those who love God in the next phrase. Those who are called according to his purpose. Now, every Christian that we know is called according to God's purpose. Every believer is. And so we're not talking about a category of super Christians who really love God, and so these things are going to work out good for them. This is for every believer, because every believer is in the category of those who love God, and every believer has been called by God according to his purpose. And so this is a promise, guys, for all of us. Then, number three, the third blessing, the Father accomplishes his eternal purposes for us. Verse 29, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. Now, if you want to know what God's purposes are for us, those who are called according to his purpose, Paul explains that in verse 29 and 30. Here's his purpose. God's purpose for believers is that he has foreknown them from eternity past. He has predestined them to actually come to faith in Christ. He has called them to actually then experience what he has predestined for them. Those whom he foreknew, predestined, and called, these he also justified. He declares them righteous when they trust in Christ as Savior. And part of this unbroken golden chain is eternity future. Glorified us as well. It's a settled deal. It's a package deal from eternity past to eternity future. This is what God's purposes are for us. And the Spirit is praying for us, among other things, so that this will happen. So, what do we do with all of this? Let me make some suggestions by way of application. First, I want to suggest that if you haven't done it yet, commit Romans 8:28 to memory. Memorize it. It won't take you very long. It won't. Then let me also suggest that you would surrender yourself to God's good purposes, he who is our loving and sovereign Father. Yield the agenda of your life to him. We're all going to go through hardship. Some of us are going to go through and have already been through unspeakable tragedy. We have to trust him. We have to yield to him and watch for the good that he will do because he loves us. And my suggestion, Lord, help these truths to go from my head to my heart. Help me to have there be a connection here so that when hardship comes, you'll steady me and your promises, and you'll bring good someday. I just want to suggest that this is a tremendous promise. Like Diane told me, we could take it to the bank. I'm just going to tell you guys as well. You can take it to the bank also. Let's pray. So, Father, I just want to thank you that we can, that you have promised this to us, that the promise of this amazing kindness of yours flows out of your sovereignty and your love. Father, help us, please help us, that when we go through the deep, deep waters, to be steadied by these promises, by your kindnesses, by your intention to do us good. You mean it for good, even though the rest of the world and the flesh and the devil mean it for evil. Make it so, Lord, please. Help us to get it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Takes to know you're near. This week, let's preach Romans 8 to our hearts, that God is working all things out for our good. You are loved.